everyone. It's wonderful to hear the buzz. That's what I call enterprising partnership style buzz. A real pleasure to welcome you here to this enterprising partnership event, celebrating and expanding the relationship between Helping Hand and UniSA. My name's Tanya Munro and I'm Deputy Vice Chancellor of Research and Innovation, and it's my great privilege today to be able to guide and facilitate this event, which I think you'll see really showcases something, a relationship that's been absolutely critical for UniSA, and I hope has had significant impact for Helping Hand over a 20-year period. And when you consider that we're a 25-year-old university, Helping Hand have been our partner for the majority of that journey. Really, what we pride ourselves on here at UniSA is being a university of enterprise and in being flexible and adaptive and good at partnering with people who can use some of the knowledge we create and make it make impact in the world, but also who can support us in our mission to deliver high quality professionals who can go out and make a really positive impact in our communities and in the workforce. I'm very proud that the Helping Hand relationship celebration and MOU signing is the second of these enterprising partnerships events. And I think it's highly appropriate given the scale of activity that we do here at UniSA in research and in teaching in this area. Now it's my great pleasure to introduce the South Australian Minister for Ageing, the Honourable Zoe Bettison MP. Zoe was elected to the South Australian Parliament as the Member for Ramsey in 2012. You have to listen to Zoe just for a moment to see her passion and strong interest in education, training and business development and in participation in the economy for all South Australians. Since coming to office, Zoe has supported the renewal of local parks and facilities, including the Salisbury Civic Square upgrade and the Creasa Park play space. Zoe has also supported new legislative measures to reduce hoon driving and graffiti, and is a strong supporter of the Skills for All program. So it was great to see in March in 2014, Zoe was appointed as a cabinet minister, and she's currently the Minister for Communities and Social Inclusion, Minister for Social Housing, Minister for the Status of Women, Minister for Ageing, Minister for Multicultural Affairs, Minister for Youth, and Minister for Volunteers. I mean, that's an amazing swathe of portfolios. Hats off to you, Zoe. And I think in all of those ministries, it's highly appropriate to have you here, and we deeply thank you for sharing your time with us today. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to acknowledge that the land we meet on today is the traditional land of the Kaurna people and that I respect their spiritual relationship with the country. It is my great pleasure to be here today at the launch of this important memorandum of understanding between Helping Hand and the University of South Australia. I particularly thank Ian Hardy, the Chief Executive Helping Hand, and Professor Tanya Munro, Deputy Vice-Chancellor, University of South Australia, for your invitation to be here. I also warmly welcome our international guest and speaker, Dr. Alexandre Kalache, back to Adelaide. For those of you who know him, he's a global leader in active ageing and age-friendly research. And Dr. Kalache brings a great prestige to his role as an adjunct professor for the University of South Australia. Today's launch of the Memorandum of Understanding is a significant milestone in a 20-year collaboration. Those two decades of collaboration are a magnificent achievement, and they'll be further consolidated today by this launch of the University of South Australia's Enterprise Partnership with Helping Hand. It's a first such partnership in the ageing sector. UniSA and Helping Hand's shared commitment shows brilliant research leadership and adds impressive critical mass to our state's vision for older South Australians. This state's appetite for productive partnerships is attracting the interest of new partners, new industries nationally and abroad. We are building a deep understanding of the services needed to create future communities, houses, workplaces and businesses. We know older people's expectation for health and well-being, recreation and lifelong learning are creating new demands for age-friendly communities, housing and technology. Indeed, across the Asia-Pacific region, by 2017, baby boomers will account for US $3 trillion in household savings. And by 2050, the number of people in the region aged 60 and older will more than quadruple to 2.45 billion. This is a global phenomenon, and we want South Australia to be a strong participant in the economic growth that will flow from it. As Minister for Ageing, I'm very pleased by the outcomes already achieved by our state ageing plan. By bringing together policymakers, service providers and industry sectors, we can respond to older people's priorities and at the same time respond to this market opportunity. In 2015, we commenced the Mature Economy Project to understand the new opportunities for South Australia's economy arising from our population ageing. Over the past 18 months, the Mature Economy Project has identified the key market sectors with potential to respond to the needs of people as they age. From this initial research, we've developed a policy framework that will create economic and social dividends for South Australia, because we are ageing fastest in the mainland state. So it makes us a great testbed to try these new ideas. We know that from this framework, new partnerships, new enterprises, and new social structures will need to evolve. This will create opportunities for older people to participate and contribute socially and economically in every way. This work is closely aligned to the Ageing Well work of the Economic Development Board and to the Premier's recent powerful endorsement of a new Ageing Well industry for South Australia. As Minister for Ageing, I want to say that the partnership we celebrate today here between UniSA and Helping Hand has the potential to add immense value to this emerging vision. And I'm really pleased to say, as alumni of the University of South Australia, I did my graduate diploma in business here 21 years ago, that South UniSA has always had a great relationship with industry. And I think we can see that they were ahead of their time in these collaborations. And naturally, Helping Hand was also ahead of its time to do that. Look, just yesterday, no, Monday, Megan and Ian came and spoke to me. I didn't know what a huge employer Helping Hand was, about 1,500, many in the northern suburbs. But what really stayed with me is your long-term commitment to having students placed in your services. Because although I was a student a long time ago, theory is one thing, but practical real experience makes all the difference and makes you a much better allied health professional when you finish. So I really want to thank you for your dedication and that true commitment to students in the past and into the future. Dr. Kalache, as always, we're absolutely delighted to have you here, and I think you can see that we've done quite a bit of work. And I'll take the opportunity to thank my Office of the Ageing. Where's Jeanette? She's here. As always, above and beyond in the work that they do. Exciting times, but we started with Prosperity for Longevity. We've got our action plan, our elder abuse time. So I really thank you for being there with us from the beginning. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today as we look at the future opportunities for a new ageing horizon. Thank you.
So the next thing that was scheduled before we ask Ian to speak and share his experiences was for us to sign the MOU. So Ian, if I can invite you across.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
If fantastic to have that MOU signed as a real signal of our growing partnership. So now it's an absolute pleasure to introduce Ian Hardy, who's been Chief Executive of Helping Hands since 1990, just an outstanding commitment. A former President of the National Aged Care Peaked Body, Aged and Community Services Australia, Mr. Ian Hardy has been a member of the board of the Adelaide Northern Medicare Local, the boards of the Repat General Hospital in Adelaide, and the International Association of Homes and Services for the Aging, Washington DC, the South Australian Ministerial Advisory Board on Aging, and the State Disability Advisory Board. He was also a member of the reference group for the Commonwealth's Hogan Pricing Review of Aged Care and of the Australian Government's Ministerial Advisory Committee on Community Care. Of particular pride to UniSA, in 2005, Ian was awarded the honorary title of University Fellow by the University of South Australia, something we reserve for significant partners and high achievers in their areas. Following our suit then, in 2008, he was appointed a member of the Order of Australia, a real honour, for service to the community, particularly in the area of aged care, as a leading contributor to the development of better services. And in the same year, he undertook a prestigious Churchill Fellowship tour to investigate consumer-directed aged care in the UK, Europe and Japan. He's a member of the governing board of the First Health Partnership Centre on Dementia and Cognitive Decline in the Elderly. And he's a chair of the Strategic Review Panel of the Wiking Trust, one of the most significant non-government funders of ageing innovation and research in Australia. And has recently been appointed to the advisory board of the School of Population Health here at UniSA. And he's also currently a member of the Federal Department of Health's advisory group engaged in the development of a new set of standards for aged care services in Australia. Now, when it comes to our interaction, Ian, I hope you don't mind me giving a glimpse of the scale of our interaction, because I think it's extraordinary for those who don't know. We've had together an extensive student placement program that started 20 years ago, but now has over 300 student placements, over 3,000 days of student placement a year. And we've had a long, rich and diverse research, partnership and relationship that has brought in funding of over $8 million. That's significant partnership, and it's a real tribute to leadership and relationship on both organisations. And I hope that today's celebration marks a growth in that clearly trusted and valued relationship for both parties. So, Ian, over to you. Thank you.
Many thanks, Tanya. It's such a pleasure to be here today to celebrate the signing of this MOU between our organisation because, as has been referred to, it really does crystallise the 20 years of joint activity between our two organisations. And it's also a particular pleasure that this occasion is being held as part of the University's Enterprising Partnerships program. We're very proud to be one of the first exemplars of the ideals of that initiative. At the outset, I'd firstly like to thank the university itself for the many opportunities we've had over the two decades. I'd like to thank Deputy Vice-Chancellor Tanya Munro for her support and leadership in leading us to this point of being able to sign off the MOU. I thank Minister Bettison for being here today to launch the MOU as well. We really do appreciate that you could be here. And finally, I thank Dr. Alex Kalache for his presence. Alex is, of course, a world authority on ageing. He wouldn't agree, but he's probably the world's leading authority on global ageing. But he's also a valued friend of Helping Hand, and we're delighted that he's here today. Now, just a little context. The formal aged care sector is probably the most underestimated area of social and economic activity in Australia. It currently turns over about $16 billion per annum through a combination primarily of government subsidies and client payments. It employs nearly 400,000 people nationally. It currently expends nearly $2 billion annually on building construction. And it's in fact growing faster than the population as a whole because of the effects of population ageing. Helping Hand, for its part, employs, as was said, about 1,500 people, and we provide services across much of South Australia. We turn over nearly $100 million annually, and we are also a significant contributor to the construction industry in this state. More importantly, though, than those indicators, Helping Hand has helped to lead national policy and service innovation to improve the lives of older people, having pioneered ageing in place in residential care, mental health services for older people, and the provision of aged care services for people with lifelong intellectual disability, amongst many other initiatives. The relationship between Helping Hand and the university grew out of early collaborations between the Division of Health Sciences and allied health staff within our organisation. Over time, Helping Hand developed links with each of UniSA's divisions and now resources a placement program which gives opportunities for students and staff from across the university to engage in clinical and other placements, research projects, and a range of innovation activities. I should add that Helping Hand benefits immeasurably from the presence of students and their fresh thinking, from the opportunity to engage with university staff around curriculum, and from the considerable research resources of the university. Over the past decade, our collaborative research projects have ranged across many areas of specialisation. A large-scale study of loneliness in older people, which began in 2006 and was really the first of the major research collaborations that we've undertaken. So in a sense, we count our research partnership from that date. But those research projects have also covered things like medication administration, effective work and work health and safety management in the context of an increasingly culturally and linguistically diverse workforce. And that's a real challenge for those of us providing services in aged care and health. Cultural and linguistic backgrounds of many of our staff make effective communication of not only health and safety information, but many other elements of information, one of our most critical challenges, and it will remain so, I think, in the future. Other research has been done on the effectiveness of exercise physiology in aged care, notably for people with dementia, and there have been many other large and small-scale areas of research. As Tanya said, more than $8 million over the last decade. Each year, Helping Hand in total places about 1,100 secondary, vet and tertiary students around the organisation. Our tertiary students come largely from this university and are drawn from a surprisingly wide range of disciplines. And it's a long list, but it's probably worth reading. They include nursing, pharmacy, podiatry, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, exercise physiology, psychology, social work, human resources, marketing, business, industrial design, and law, so perhaps not those that you might have expected would be coming to us in their entirety. Over the years, the student experience within Helping Hand has become increasingly diverse. By way of example, Helping Hand and UniSA pioneered the placement of fourth-year pharmacy students within our facilities. Those four-week placements enabled final-year pharmacy students to engage with older people and our staff, as well as community pharmacists who supply services to those facilities. Feedback from students indicated the placements were very valuable indeed, and some said formative for them, as many students had not previously had much interaction with older people outside of their immediate families. And of course, most pharmacists are going to find that the majority of their professional lives will involve dealing with older people. So it's a very good mini study of the absolute relevance of being able to bring those mature students into our environment. Another recent example involved an exercise physiology student who elected to work closely with a gentleman living in one of our facilities, a gentleman who was living with severe dementia. He'd been very withdrawn and not spoken in many months. Through the student's gentle engagement and stimulation, that gentleman has begun to use language again to communicate with his family. There are many, many examples across our organisation where student enthusiasm, perhaps the time available as well to work with individuals and groups of residents and clients, has had that kind of outcome. It should be said as well that students also contribute professional stimulation for our own staff by questioning and debating professional practice, and that's very valuable from our perspective. It's really one of the things that we get out of having those students with us across the organisation. In addition to the student placement and research activities, Helping Hand has contributed to ageing and aged care policy and practice awareness within the university through lectures and other formats to groups of undergraduate and postgraduate students. And in earlier years, a previous Vice-Chancellor used to invite me to come in and talk to her pro-Vice-Chancellors about ageing and the opportunities that every discipline within the university would have in the ageing sphere. We hope that all of the activities that have been mentioned contribute to students' understanding of the sector and the future opportunities that they will have within it. We are very excited about the history of our association with the university, and we're very excited about the future because we can build obviously on what is already a very firm and a very active base, and so we're very excited about the potential for the future as well as enjoying the achievements of the past. In finishing, I do want to acknowledge the many Helping Hand staff who are intrinsic to the relationship, particularly Jan van Emden and Helen Loeffler for their student engagement facilitation, and especially Megan Corliss, our Director of Research and Development, who has led this journey with UniSA for 20 years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ian, for your inspiring, warm and welcoming words. Really deeply appreciated. It's my pleasure to add my vote of welcome to Alex Kalache, who has been introduced now not once, twice, but three times. Alex is a world-renowned specialist in age-related issues, and he's long been a pioneer and an advocate in issues related to ageing. And I think our state stood up and listened in making ageing well one of our 10 economic priorities. And so the long advocacy and a lot of the depth of commitment, both from Helping Hand and UniSA, I think benefit from that visibility of this real opportunity for our state to be a leader in this sector. Of particular note, from 1995 to 2008, Dr. Kalache directed the World Health Organization's Global Programme on Ageing in Geneva. And amongst many other enduring initiatives, he conceived and launched the WHO Active Ageing Policy Framework and the WHO Age Friendly Cities Project. The thing I first heard about you from was when you were one of our notable thinkers in residence, and your contribution from that time still echoes through South Australia on a regular basis. So please introduce you.
Thank you so much for this very welcome and very warm welcome, Vice Chancellor. I'm absolutely delighted to be here because when I am in Adelaide, I'm at home. I have tremendous appreciation for all the warmth, all that I have received from you in terms of friendship and the opportunities. The opportunities to work with a very vibrant group. I don't know if you are familiar with the notion of the thinking residency more intimacy, but it's not only the South Australian government, it's also open to partners. And one of our partners was, of course, Helping Hands, and the friendship that we developed, Ian and Megan, my dear friend, and I could call you a nanny. You were really following me, and it was terrific. A minder, let's say. That's better. And also the University of South Australia, and I now have the... it's tremendously pleasing for me to be an adjunct professor at the university here, and a role that I really hope that I will return with enthusiasm. And Minister, it's amazing. You could not be a man. A multitask minister with 7 portfolios. Only a woman could do it. And I do really appreciate all that you have been doing and in many different ways following the recommendations of my report as thinking residents. If you look at this leaflet that is outside there, explaining all the research opportunities and what the university is doing and accomplishing, you will see here the research themes. And if you look at the research themes, the one that really appeals to me immediately is an aging-friendly world. When I was at WHO, I had the opportunity, the privilege, of launching what is now a very influential force throughout the world. We start with 33 cities around the world, using the same protocol, doing the rigor that only the academia can do. So it was not an idea that we then launched, but really doing a qualitative research with the same methodology, with the same protocol, looking at the same 8 dimensions in parallel in 33 cities, big cities like Tokyo, like Moscow, or like Buenos Aires and Rio, but also smaller cities and 5 or 6 small towns, so that we could have a taste of big, macro, small, west and east and north and south, developing. And with the results of this study, involved more than 3,000 older people and their carers, also providers of services, we could launch the WHO guide for age-friendly cities. That is what we could call partnership. It didn't cost WHO one single dollar because WHO doesn't have any money. So we have to do with inspiring people, trying to inspire, to do the partnerships, to do together, really hand in hand. And we succeeded. It was so pleasing for me to be at the helm at the time, to come with the idea, and now to see 1,800 cities around the world following the steps. Yesterday, the office for the aged, and Janet is here, facilitating a meeting together with the city of Anli, one of the very first cities in Australia to join the WHO family. And we had a meeting over the last couple of days with age-friendly cities in Australia. Why is that possible? Because there is partnership. And when I think in terms of partnerships, I'm not thinking only in terms of the partnerships that would be natural for academic centers to be in partnerships, to have a network, or the age-friendly cities to have a network. It's not only partnerships and networks of the equals. It is really the partnership of people that can mix together because they have differences, and these differences will add far more and will bring added value. This is what you are doing, Ian, and I was so impressed with helping hands when I first came here, and to see the vibrance and a team, to see all that you were doing in terms of research without even calling it research sometimes, although, Megan, you are the research director, but it is building that commitment to measure what you are doing. And measuring is very important. This is the vocation of the university. So if you bring together, in this case, the private sector, that is to some extent also a civil society organization, if you bring the public sector and you bring the academia, you have all the ingredients that we can really be sure that we are going to make progress, because you have the academia with the rigor, you have the private sector with the commitment that they often do, not always, to do it right. Also with the resources. I'm speaking as a Brazilian. We are in deep recession in Brazil. I wouldn't be able to do anything without the support of the private sector. And we work together with respect, keeping the dignity, with the autonomy, and we can work together very well. 2 weeks from now, we are going to have an international longevity forum in Brazil. It's the 4th time. With the private sector, it's an insurance company. It's the 2nd largest bank in Brazil. I'm proud to do this and to have them as partners. And if they wouldn't come with the resources to facilitate what we're doing, we wouldn't do so many things. For instance, one of the first findings that we had when we first started and launched the age-friendly cities idea in my home city in Rio, Copacabana, which is a vertical district. People live on top of each other. It is virtually, you know, in apartment buildings. And down there, you still have the figure of a friend of older people. In all the focus groups, older people, one way or the other, would refer to the porters, to the doorman, as our friends. I remember an old woman who said in one of the focus groups, every night I pray for my porter so that he doesn't die before me, because he's getting old, you know. And if he dies before me, I would be lost. You see the importance of that agent, the community agent, for her well-being, which is the theme of the conference that is going to open tomorrow for the next 3 days. Well-being, resilience, positive psychology. Well, that porter is absolutely essential for that. What this bank and insurance company is doing, they are helping me to train the porters. They are friends, but they don't have the tools. So if we can bring them with the tools, training, lifelong learning, we can be sure that not only they are going to be friends, but they will be more effective in that friendship, helping so many older people that had identified them as their best friends. This is partnership. And without these linkages, we cannot really go further in this mission. This is a mission that is very important because it affects all of us. We're talking about a longevity revolution. When I was born in Brazil, life expectancy was a mere 43 years. It's now approaching 77. We're not talking about 34 years, extra additional years of old age. We are talking about 34 years of life. The longevity revolution has a retroactive effect on every single stage of our lives. We need to get prepared for this longevity revolution. We have just finished the Olympic Games in Brazil, so I bring this analogy. In the past, when life expectancy was 43, and in Australia, the turn of the last century was 46, the highest in the world, life was a bit like a 100-meter sprint. You would come with all your gas and energy to come to the end. Today is a marathon. Today you need strategies. You need tools. You need to know what you are going to do in order to get there at the end of the marathon in good shape. Or else you are not going to accomplish it. We have to be developing a culture of care. That is what you do in helping agents so well. A culture of care that will embrace everybody. Those that receive care, but also those that are providing care. And you have extended this to the university. You are giving the opportunity for young students, postgraduate or undergraduate students, to come and learn in that culture of care, and also have one of the most important gerontological principles today, which is generativity, activity between generations. It is that old lady that is in contact with a student of physiotherapy. I saw the other day something that may be familiar to some of you, a very short video of an experience in the Netherlands where you have residential care and you have students that will live there free in exchange of 15 hours of their time every week. It's not the older people that are profiting. You have to see the joy, the pride, and what these young guys are receiving in turn, because they are sharing, because they are developing this culture of care, because they are nourishing. We have lost this in our extended families that have gone. We cannot be nostalgic and say, I want to have my grandchildren around me in the same way that as a grandchild I was around my grandparents. That's past. But if you nourish, if you develop these partnerships, if you facilitate this exchange, the young and the old, we are going to profit, because think, there is only one alternative to old age. What do you prefer? Thank you.
Dr. Kalache, please let me have the honour of giving you a gift to thank you for your wonderful talk.
Thank you.
Remember us by.
If you didn't think it was a wonderful talk, I wouldn't take it.
Well, I have to say that your examples, your passion, the wisdom in your words struck home, and for me as a 43-year-old, I'm living in terror now. Look, thank you. From hearing from both of you, the clear need for this type of partnership, for this type of work. It's really moving. It makes us inspired to advance our research and its impact and our partnership. Also, when I hear of some of the challenges that are faced in other countries and I think about how it applies to South Australia, I think we particularly need to look at examples like the one you flagged in the Netherlands. I saw that video too on Facebook, it went past, and the young student profile looked happy. He, you know, and the opportunity to get an education and to have your housing costs met for free by contributing back seems to me an extraordinary social initiative. But again, thank you all for your time and for being here. I wanted to just wrap up by giving an example here of a student who I suspect is the same student that was mentioned by you, but Alison Pennington, where are you? There you go, Alison, hello. Really as a wonderful illustration and example of what this partnership brings us. Because through Alison's placement as a UniSA exercise physiology student, and now as an exercise physiologist employed by Helping Hand and delivering valuable outcomes every day in your work, you're an illustration of what our partnership's about. And I'd like to hold you up as an example for what we hope to continue to do into the future. Also, before we kind of break for drinks, nibbles and networking, I wanted to take the chance too to have a huge vote of thanks to some UniSA staff who've been pivotal in this relationship now and over the years. And in particular, I'd like to acknowledge Esther May, Wendy Lacey, Angela Scarino, Lisa McDonald, Bob Vink, all of you for your leadership, for your persistence and for your contribution to making this partnership strong. Thank you very much. And please, if you have any ideas for collaborations, for partnerships, we've got some postcards that can be filled out and put into a huge big fishbowl that Lisa's holding up over there. Thank you for joining us.